flex shape, top dollar magazines, putting money into the individual, showing how they can look good. You see that now muscle is not unacceptable, it's become socially acceptable, and because of all of our work, it's now socially desirable. I mean, all of a sudden, everybody wants muscle.
Gladys Portuguese is a world-class bodybuilder. Corey Everson is the 1984-85 Miss Olympia World Champion. Together, they're bodybuilding's glamour girls, modeling everything from sportswear to evening gowns, redefining what the healthy American woman looks like, because fitness in the 80s is more than a fad, it's a lifestyle.
All of a sudden, there's this big boom on being slim and toned and fit. Jane Fonda, Linda Evans, everybody is promoting fitness.
The longer you train, the more you get to know your body and the more you start appreciating yourself. And you feel, you feel a lot sexier and nicer and,
You know what I like? About pumping up.
Rachel McLeish is yet another bodybuilder with some marketing muscle. As the present spokesperson for Holiday Health Clubs, she's legitimized a bodybuilding campaign that was previously promoted by celebrity sex symbols. Today, advertisers are gambling that muscle and femininity can be sold in the same package.
Before you primp, you gotta pump.
We do a lot of advertising for companies that would like to have that, use that symbol of somebody who's healthy and vibrant and vivacious and looks like they've got their bodies very cleaned up and well-developed. They use these people to symbolize that their company is also a reputable company.
Good shot. Keep going, guys.
People like Gladys and Corey, not only do the women want to look like these women, but the men want to look at these women.
You're going to see a lot more of them, chiseled and glistening. Advertisers are making sure of that. But is this the image that mainstream America is really looking for? We showed people two photographs of Gladys. 65% of the men and women surveyed felt that she looked unfeminine in this shot from competition. But in this advertisement, each and every one questioned thought that she had sex appeal. Given that these were two photographs of the same person, how can such differing statistics be explained?
It's definitely a question of presentation. The exercise pictures and the physique photographs we'll take today, you know, compare those with the pictures Harry's going to take tomorrow. And the girls won't be flexed, and they won't have a lot of oil in their bodies, probably. And the look will be, and his lighting will be considerably different.
Hit it, Corey. Corey, you got such a great smile. That's it.
Glamour photographer Harry Langdon did indeed portray bodybuilders in a different light. For example, on the left, hard and crisp, the presentation enhances muscularity, while on the right, a softer, warmer photograph makes the muscle look less prominent. Could this explain the difference in those statistics? Perhaps bodybuilding's traditional presentation of muscular women has been responsible for many years of public ridicule.
When I'm out in normal clothing, people don't know I'm a bodybuilder because you look just like somebody who's got very good shape.
If I dress a certain way, I feel feminine and I feel very sexy. When I weight train, I don't wear just sweatpants and sweatshoes and cover up and everything, you see. I wear nice, sexy things, which when you look at yourself in the mirror, you feel sexy and you feel pretty and you just feel right. You just feel like a lady, period.
Models with muscle first appeared in ancient Greek sculpture, and today that aesthetic is once again popular. In fact, there's a modeling agency in New York called Better Bodies that represents muscular models from around the world. Obviously, marketing muscle has proven to be one powerful advertising posture.
She was fired. Now, my station, just they jumped at the chance. They thought that was great. Free promotion.